Hey PC World fans, Adam here with the review of the Intel Core i5-14600K. Now I have reviewed so far the 14700K and the 14900K, both of which you can see on the channel and in the link over here in the player. So I'm not gonna go into all the configuration details and the preamble of the other reviews. This one, I'm just gonna go straight into the performance benchmarks. TLDR, 14th gen is just a slight Raptor Lake refresh of 13th gen. So there's a little bit of improvements here, a little bit of improvements there, but not a ton to write home about. But I did want to put it through the full testing suite in these benchmarking rigs that I have. Now around here, we like to start off with rendering workloads. And even though I have all the other CPUs that I've tested on these charts, I'm mostly going to be focusing on the 14600K and how it compares to the 13600K and also the AMD Ryzen 7 7700X. So first up is Cinebench R23 single threaded. And as you can see on those Core i5 results, because of that clock bump and other little improvements, we are getting a bigger bar. And it does catch up with that last gen 13700K. And comparing it to the Ryzen 7, it does pull ahead a little bit. The 13600K was pretty much neck and neck with the 7700X, but this pulls it ahead just a little bit. But let's move over to multi-threaded, because the 14600K, even though it doesn't have extra cores or new cores added to it in 14th gen, it does have a core count advantage over the Ryzen part. Now looking at the generational results from 13th gen to 14th gen, yes, we see a slight improvement, but not a ton. And it still holds a nice lead over the 7700X. But Cinebench is not the only rendering workload around here. Next up, let's look at Blender 3.6.0. It actually renders out three different scenarios. And even though at the top end chips, the AMD systems have an advantage over the Intel systems, down here at the Core i5 and Ryzen 7 level, the 14600K and even the 13600K actually perform just a bit better than the 7700X in each one of these scenarios. Generationally, I'm gonna call this kind of margin of error. I'm not seeing a ton of uplift, but for the same price as the 7700X, we are getting a little bit better performance. One more rendering workload, and this is V-Ray 5. Once again, at this top end, AMD typically has an advantage, but as we move down to the Core i5 and look at it against the Ryzen 7, it's actually pretty neck and neck and pulls ahead just a little bit in 14th gen. Still not a huge win like the Ryzen 9 does over the Core i9. I would say this is more of a wash and neck and neck. But let's move on from rendering workloads and move more into content creation. First up we have is Handbrake, and this is a 4K video transcode. I'm not gonna go into all the details here. You can actually look in the description for all the settings that I put in Handbrake for this particular transcode. And we know that Intel has a favorable advantage in Handbrake, and that is no different when we get down to this Core i5. Looking generationally, we're actually not seeing like a huge improvement here. But if we're looking at rendering this 4K video in more than a minute for the Intel system versus the Ryzen 7 7700X, then that's actually pretty good. As some would say, time is money, and if you can render faster, then it can save you money. Now let's look at Adobe Premiere Pro. This is the extended overall score, and the performance tracks with the different core and Ryzen numbers that we have. If we look at AMD versus Intel, traditionally Intel has an advantage here in Premiere Pro, but it's not really until you look at the subscores where you can tell where it picks up that advantage. So if we switch over to the subscores, yes, the 14600K does better than the 7700X in RAW. Intraframe and GPU effects, it's within margin of error. Really, it's that long GOP codec or long GOP compression where the Intel systems really pull ahead. And it doesn't matter Core i5 versus Ryzen 9, those Intel systems are definitely getting a huge performance uplift in LongOp. So if you specifically use that format, Intel systems are kind of one of the ones you want to look at first. But if you're looking at the overall platform, and especially if you're not editing in like 8K or 4K, then I would say they're actually pretty even. Moving on to photo editing, we have Lightroom Classic. Now, first up, this is the overall score. And it actually tracks kind of like what we saw with the Premiere, where Intel has a slight advantage. But if we go over to the subscores, we can see that in active, which is actually moving around and editing the photos, you can see that the Intel systems definitely have an uplift there. And then in passive, which is actually taking those photos and exporting them, Intel has an uplift there as well. In terms of generation though, this is within margin of error generationally, so not really much of an improvement to write home about. And the last of the content creation apps is Photoshop. This is the overall score, and surprisingly, the 7700X actually turns in a better overall score than either of the Core i5s, and gets it pretty damn close to that Core i7 from 13th gen. So we gotta dig into the subscores, and I'm sorry, this is a lot of numbers to look at, but it's not coming from one place. It actually is each one of these subscores. That 7700X outperforms in its weight class. And honestly, I'm kind of surprised. I need to go back and double check these numbers, but the filter score and the GPU score, that 7700X actually had the best score compared to the other AMD systems. Generationally, again, we're not seeing much of an uplift, if any. It's kind of within margin of error. Now let's move over to productivity kind of tasks. This will kind of tell you how it is to just use the system day to day on lightly threaded kind of stuff. First up, we have Crossmark here. This is the overall score. You know, and it's pretty neck and neck between the Core i5 and the Ryzen 7. So we gotta once again dig into the subscores to kind of see where this is from. And really, productivity is actually pretty damn close, but creativity and responsiveness give the edge to the Intel-based systems. And actually, surprisingly, we see a little bit more separation than usual from the 13th gen to the 14th gen i5s. I'm sure it's not a ton, and I'd have to dig into the sub scores to see where we're picking that up, but it's actually, you know, it's a healthy little bump, I guess. Next up is Web Expert. This was captured in Google Chrome. And I mean, honestly, this is nothing really to talk about. This is all within margin of error. Almost everything from the top-end chips to the lower-end chips are probably gonna, surprisingly, work really well in Google Chrome. And of course, Gordon wanted me to run Geekbench, which he dubs the official benchmark of Twitter arguments. If we look at the single core score, the 14th gen does pick up a little bit of a bump, but not enough to catch up to AMD. So AMD wins there. If we look at multi-core, yes, we do once again get a little bump from the 13600K to the 14600K. And both of those chips actually beat out the 7700X. So go ahead and take those numbers and argue on Twitter all you want. Next up, let's get to gaming. I didn't do a ton of deep game testing. I leave a lot of that game testing to others on YouTube, so definitely go watch some other videos. But I kind of wanted to dig in to see if, you know, if there's any real tangible benefits from like a, say, a Core i5 to a Core i9, which, I mean, can sometimes be half the price. First up is Shadow of the Tomb Raider. If we're looking at just the two Core i5 chips, this is essentially within margin of error. If we compare it to the 7700X, yes, technically it gets the win there, but once again, you're not gonna feel it too much. Really, Shadow of the Tomb Raider loves that 3D V-cache, and no other chips can catch up to that, even that expensive 14900K. So let's switch over to Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, which is running at really high frame rates here. We are not seeing a huge jump from 13th gen to 14th gen, but AMD definitely has more of an advantage at these lower price points compared to the higher price points of the Intel systems. Though we are seeing that benefit of the 3D V-Cache here, especially with that 7800X 3D. But when we're talking about low to mid 500 frames a second, this is also not a huge thing to write home about. Next up, we have Total War Warhammer 3. This actually has a couple different benchmark modes in it. I ran the battle and the campaign. The battle gave me some interesting results, I will say, and I don't, I don't fully understand why they turned out this way. I actually don't feel like the battle benchmark is the most reliable one to run. So instead, I'm just going to focus on the campaign. And the Intel chips are actually pretty damn good, all within the low 200s. And compared to AMD, specifically that 7700X, the Core i5s definitely beat it out there. But it does not beat out that 7800X3D with the 3D V-Cache. A couple more games here to go. This one is Watch Dogs Legion, and oh boy, we can see this game definitely loves that V-Cache. But not only that, if we look at the 7700X versus both of those Core i5s, we're turning in a bigger bar better on the AMD system for sure. Not only in the average FPS, but also in the 1% lows. I was actually surprised to see such a gap between the Core i9s, Core i7s, and Core i5s. I need to go back and double check my numbers here, but there is a pretty big difference here to check out. And the second to last benchmark is Final Fantasy XIV, and I run this both at 1080p and 4K just to kind of see how the scaling of the resolutions pertain to the CPU. First up, we're going to look at 1080p, which is typically more CPU bound, and we can see that, I mean, we're actually pretty damn close generationally compared to the 7700X, which does have a slight lead. It's still not a ton, and to be honest, all these are actually pretty damn close within that 300 FPS. Surprisingly though, at 4K, the AMD system starts to do worse than the Intel systems. Except for those two 3D V-Cache parts, those can keep up. But the non-V-Cache AMD chips fall behind at 4K, which is kind of interesting because you would think at 4K this is going to be more GPU bound. So that's quite interesting. And the last game that I have here is Cyberpunk 2077. This is with the RT Overdrive mode, but I am not using upscaling or DLSS. So this is pretty heavily GPU bound. I thought maybe running this would actually show a little bit of a difference between the CPUs, but as we can see here, this is all within margin of error. Yes, Intel has technically an advantage over all of the AMD parts, but still, this is obviously a GPU-bound scenario, and we're not really getting too much information here. The last major thing to talk about is power consumption, and what I've said in all the other videos, and I will say again here, typically at the lighter core counts, Intel has a slight power advantage compared to AMD, but when we start to really fire up all those cores, Intel does consume more power, and therefore will probably put off a little bit more heat than the AMD systems. It's not as pronounced here at the i5 level compared to up at the i9, but that same story just kind of plays out between Intel and AMD, at least in this generation, and the i5 is nothing different. So to kind of conclude all of the numbers that we're looking for, first up, talking about the jump from 13th gen to 14th gen on these i5 parts, yeah, there's not much to write home about. A slight clock boost and a couple of feature sets that hopefully will give a little bit more performance. But other than that, especially if you're already on a 13th gen system, there's zero reason to upgrade. Maybe there's a reason to pick up a 14th gen system if you're building new, but also maybe these 13th gen chips at the i5 level will start to get a little bit of a discount. So you're gonna have to kind of, you know, gauge what you want there. AMD versus Intel though, specifically that 7700X with eight big cores, it kind of depends on the scenario, right? We kind of saw, some Intel lead here, AMD lead there, but honestly, it wasn't by a ton. I didn't feel like there was one place specifically that really kind of made a huge difference. There were some notable exceptions in that, and that's like Longop in Premiere Pro, But once again, Premiere Pro, you know, it depends on your editing workload and what you do, if you're looking for something specific like that. If you do want to step up to the 7800X3D, yes, you are going to get a little bit less performance on the work side of it, right? The rendering and the video production and things like that. But man, what you gain on the gaming side is pretty damn phenomenal. So, you know, that's something to think about if you want to kind of spend a little bit more money. But for the most part, gaming, you're going to be fine even down at the i5 level. So with that is all of the 14th gen CPUs reviewed. Once again, go back and watch the other reviews if you're looking for something a little bit more expensive. But I was glad to at least put that i5 number into the charts here so that I can kind of see the full stack and see how performance stacks up across the board. Next up, I'm probably going to be taking all of these scores and kind of breaking them out into different individual application performance and looking at all the subscores and kind of really combing over and making determinations based off of use case and workload, which one is better than the other. But for now, that was my review of the Intel Core i5-14600K. Thank you everybody for watching, and be sure to subscribe here on PC World for more PC hardware and software goodness. We'll check you out in the next one.